this morning. We'll add to the prayers from what's on your paperwork, Carol Anderson's granddaughter, and for those who have been a part of this church for a long time, that's her oldest daughter, Kathy's daughter, Amy, who is 10 weeks pregnant, and she has a number of blood clots, so she is in need of our prayers. Also, Dolores Gillette's niece, her mother-in-law, Eunice Storm, is really having problems. And so we'll be lifting up Eunice this morning as well. Couple of announcements. We have another week for anyone who wants to go into the school and go through things to purchase for your family or for others that you know. We have someone coming this Wednesday to be looking at our school furniture. But our hope is to have a sale on the 7th of August. And we need our people to be helping with that. We'll need some people to help move stuff if we decide to move it outside, which would probably be better. Also, we need people to help sit at the cell and help. So Jamie and the SLT are asking that people sign up for 2-hour increments of time to be helping with that. You can put, if it's hot out, we'll let you have an umbrella, okay, so you're cool. But we do need people to help. Please, please, please sign up to do that. There'll be something coming out before long. I think we've already sent out one thing through emails. There'll be information in the newsletter, which you'll receive midweek through email. And then for those who aren't on email, you'll get it by Saturday. Just so you're aware of that. Bible studies, regular times on Tuesday and Thursday, 1 o'clock and 6:30 by Zoom on Tuesday. And on Thursday, it's in person here at the church. I can't hear you. One more week for underwear for
next Sunday.
By next Sunday.
That's going to be the end of that.
Okay, and for Aurora Warms the Nights. So small and medium, boxers for the men, briefs for the women. All right, with that, let's please stand and turn our hearts and our minds to Christ. Our worship this morning begins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's take a moment for silence and for self-examination. Gives us This is Isaiah's commission from God. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above him were seraphim, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory." At the sound of their voices, the doorposts and thresholds shook, and the temple was filled with smoke. "Woe to me," I cried, "I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty." Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, "See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for." And I heard a voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me." The second reading is according to Acts, the first chapter, beginning with the first verse. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift of my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." Here ends the second reading. Please stand for the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel is according to Matthew 28, beginning with verse 16.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to him and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We sing the hymn of the day.
Thank you.
I know I'm moving a lot slower these days. Let us pray. Oh Lord, there are many in our world and even in our community around us that do not know you. Would you use us to reach those around us for you? Get us out of our comfort zone so that you can use us as you wish. We thank you for your Holy Spirit and for the calling that we all have received. And we pray that you would move us to focus on your ministry and our mission and my mission as individuals, the community, as you wish. And now may the words of my mouth and meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you and to you alone, for you are our Redeemer, Christ Jesus the Lord. Amen and amen. Grace to you and peace from our Lord and our Savior Jesus the Christ, who was, who is, and who will always be. Take my voice and let me sing always, only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee. Words that we've sung for a long time, just a different tune. Take our lives, Lord, right? That's what we asked for. When you brought your children to be baptized, you gave them over to God. And you said, these are your children, Lord. They're no longer ours, but we will teach them in your ways. Or when you were baptized, your parents brought you forward and gave you over to God and said, Lord, these children are yours. But we forget that in our life. We get overwhelmed with the world. And so refocusing is always good. So we're at the last of four sessions in our series on focus. And it's focus on your mission. Not our mission. Focus on your mission. How do we rethink what we do and how we live to say that the calling is to us? The first week, we focused on God's good. And the second week, we focused on Jesus, on Christ. And last week, it was focusing on your future or my future. It's how we relate and how God is a part of our decision-making, how God uses us along the way, and now it's focus on our mission. Our mission should be God's mission. Your mission should be God's mission. And what we know is that God has called each one of us. Truly, He called you. Whether you remember it, whether you think about it, whether you know it, whether you heard the words, my guess is not one of you has heard, like Isaiah did, who will go for us? Who will we send? Has anyone heard those words out loud, in your ear, in your mind? Just asking. I will tell you, there are all of us who have heard God in one way or another. Some of us have heard God's word come in our minds. There are those moments. But most of the time, it's through the scriptures or through something in our heart that doesn't speak loud, but it's the drawing that says, you belong to me, and now here's what we do. So Isaiah said, okay, Lord, I'll go for you. So you have the call of Isaiah. And then you have the disciples, and Jesus says, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you will become my witnesses, and you will go to all the ends of the earth. It's hard enough for us to go across the street, right? For some of us, it's hard enough to go to our neighbor. It's hard enough to speak to the person we meet on the street or to be kind. It's hard enough for us to talk to a family member about Christ when we know they don't really know Him. Isn't it? what? Come on, you all know. Go and make what? I didn't hear you.
Disciples.
Make disciples. You go and make disciples. That is followers of Jesus. You go. If you go to Wartburg Seminary, above the altar area is a beautiful stained glass window. And Jesus is standing like this with his finger pointed out. You go and make disciples of all nations. But it's not just for the pastors to do or for the disciples to do. It is for you to do. You personally have a calling from Jesus Christ to change someone's life with the message of Jesus. If you believe that he's touched your life and changed you, why wouldn't you want someone else to have the same message? If you truly believe that God is the greatest in all of creation, then why wouldn't we want with joy to tell someone else that message? It's just hard to do, especially in this day and age, right? Who do I tell? How do I tell them? When I was in college at Wartburg, Good Lutheran College as it was, we had people from all over the world that were staying there and going to school. And in the house that I stayed in, there were 24 of us, there was two young women who were from Japan, and they were Buddhists. And Etsuko and I were talking one day, and she said, "Why are you a Christian?" And I said, "Well," and I proceeded to talk about God's grace and mercy and love. And after an hour, yes, I can talk for an hour. After about an hour, she said, "You're the first one I asked who actually said something besides, because my parents raised me in the church." She'd been going around Wartburg talking to other students to find out why they followed Jesus. Think about it in your life. We can easily say, because my parents raised me in the church, right? Because I came to Sunday school. Well, not anymore. People don't come to Sunday school anymore. Even the large churches have smaller Sunday schools than they should have, based on the number of people that are there, because parents don't want to bring their children to Sunday school. And that's the truth of the day. So we went to Sunday school, and in seventh grade, we went to confirmation. And for 3 years, for us on Saturday mornings, for 3 hours, oh, let me just take a stop here. For 3 hours, we had confirmation. Not 1 hour, not 2 hours, 3 hours. Anybody else have that same experience out there? There's a few of us, right?
This is most certainly true.
It was just the joy of life, wasn't it? And I remember thinking, I couldn't be a pastor at the time. They didn't ordain women. I wanted to tell the story of Jesus. I would go home and preach to my dolls. I would line them up after church. I would get out the old red hymnal. That's not as old as the old black hymnal. I got out the old red hymnal, not the red hymnal we have now. Oh, that's cranberry. And I would go through the whole liturgy. And I would preach sermons to my dolls. And I would draw pictures of myself in the pulpit. And my mom said, "Girls can't do that." But I do remember being in confirmation and being bored stiff by our pastors. Not the lay people that taught, but by our pastors. They were a little odd. We were kind of afraid of them. And I thought to myself, if I'm ever a pastor, I don't preaching to a bunch of dolls that couldn't respond. Actually, sometimes that's like being in church, huh? Jesus called me. But understand, Jesus called you just like me. Jesus truly has spoken to your heart, whether you understand it, whether you feel it, whether you know it or not. When you are baptized into his name, he called you. He called you by name. You were baptized in the name of not yourself, but in the name of the greatest of all, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, who empowers you and empowers me to bring his word of life to those around us, to touch someone with his love. You don't have to be terrible. You don't have to smack someone on the head with the Bible. Back to college again, I remember I had two groups of friends, the heathens and the Bible babers. Sounds fun, huh? My heathen friends didn't want anything to do with the Christians that they called the Bible babers. Because the Bible babers, oh, just a second. They traded a small Bible for a big Bible. And what they would do was smack people on the head with the word of God telling them that they were not saved. And that was their starting point. Their starting point was to tell the world how terrible it was, as opposed to starting with how marvelous God is. That's our call. We don't have to be nasty. We have to be loving. We have to be kind. We have to be gentle. We have to be patient and understanding. Because the grace of God truly is more than we can ever imagine, and it's our gift to give. It's not a demand of God. It is a gift. Lest you should boast. That's from Ephesians, by the way. You have been empowered. I've been empowered. The church has been empowered to tell of the gracious love of Jesus Christ. And whether it's Isaiah saying, I will go for you, send me. Or it's the disciples standing on a hill somewhere outside of Jerusalem, when Jesus says, the Holy Spirit will come upon you and you will be my witnesses. Or what Matthew says, therefore go into all the world and all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them everything I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always to the end of the earth. You are not alone in your mission. We as a church are not alone in our mission, but it feels like it sometimes, doesn't it? Does it not feel like sometimes we're floating out here in Aurora, Colorado, wondering if anyone else cares that we believe in Jesus? This little light of mine, what? I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Put it under a no. I'm gonna let it shine. Put it under a bushel. No. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Why is that so hard? Why is it hard to be the church in the 21st century? Why is it difficult to tell somebody that you believe Jesus is your Lord? Why is it so difficult sometimes to hold on to the promise that you have the Holy Spirit of God dwelling in you? Why is it so hard to forget that we are a part of the mission of Jesus Christ, and yet we are afraid to say who we belong to. We have to figure it out, people. Because there is somebody who is waiting to know their love. Back in the day, the missionaries went all over. Do you know where there are more Lutherans than anywhere in the world, and it's not Germany? They don't even worship them. Yes.
Africa
has more Lutherans, more excited Christians. Period. Peter, are there excited Christians in Africa? You don't know. You're here. But I know from my friends who are over there, the pastors that I know from Africa, I remember that there was a pastor from Tanzania who was at the last assembly of the old American Lutheran Church. And you know what he said to us as he stood up to all the pastors and lay people? He said, "You all sent missionaries to us, but I think it's time for us to send missionaries to you. You all do not understand the power of God's Holy Spirit. You do not believe that God has the power to heal and to touch people's lives. You don't believe that God has the power to cast out demons and to give you new life." And many of the pastors sat there and thought, "What in the world is he talking about?" But I will tell you, he was right. We have lost the fire of Jesus Christ in this world, in this country. We have lost the fire of the Holy Spirit in our presence. We have lost the power of Jesus Christ to touch and change people's lives through you and through me. Why is that? Why is it we have no passion? I'm feeling passionate right now. At least smile. I truly am feeling passionate about it. Can you tell? We no longer send missionaries with fervency. Why? Because we're not fervent any longer. Focus on your mission, people. Start at home. Start at the grocery store. Talk to the people who serve you. I did a funeral yesterday for a woman who was raised Lutheran. And there were a lot of people at the funeral. Her brother talked for 40 minutes before I got a chance. But one of the things he said was that she knew no strangers. And when she threw herself a 65th birthday party, she invited her friends from Dean Supers, who had waited on her for years. They were part of her world, and that's what we're supposed to be about. Make people part of your world. That's where it begins, right? And then the opening comes for them to say, "Where does your joy come from?" Let me tell you the answer. Jesus Christ, Lord of heaven and earth. And the earth is full of his glory. And he loves you from the bottom of his heart. He loves me, and he changed my life. We are blessed people. We are blessed people. I have this weird picture in my mind of all of you dancing. That is really weird. Bill, I can't imagine it. Does he dance? I don't know. But dancing in the light of God, there is nothing there. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, how thankful we are. for your Holy Spirit, for your call, for your desire for us to follow you. It's your little light through us shining that becomes our little light in our neighborhood. But we cannot contain you. Thank you, God.
Her health is bad and she's
experienced a stroke and a heart attack and is on a ventilator. Touch her body and bring your healing. For George and Sally Odenheimer. For Bob Moose, Mary Lou Brunstein, Mike Lemke, and Rick and Norma Briding as Rick's mom passed into your glory. For Carol Smith, Wanda Kinsley, for Jeannie, Susan Armour's uncle, Bob McKinney. For Catherine Burns as she prepares for surgery on her hip in a couple of weeks, and for Carol Kirkegaard for her back procedure. For Bob French as he heals from surgery, and the family of Peggy Kelly as she went into the arms of Jesus last week, a friend of yours, Roy. And we especially lift up her family and her daughter, Diane. With our shut-ins. Be with those who need you, Lord. Lord, in your mercy. We give you thanks for Dan Rasmussen, Scott and Paula Petra, Madison and Faith, and for Cindy and Randy Peters. We thank you for them and their ministry, and we ask that you would use them wherever they are. Lord, in your mercy. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. As we prepare for communion, I would ask that you take the top off first, and then there's a little lid inside that lid to pull back. And now the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you in favor and grant you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We sing our closing song, Here I Am, Lord.
I don't know.